These epic structures have something in common. Red sandstone base and a white marble finish at the top. This concept is the foundation of Indo-Islamic architecture. The 72.5 meter tall Qutb Minar is the world's tallest brick minaret, and it is named after India's first Muslim ruler, Qutbuddin Aibak. Construction of this minaret commenced in 1193 AD. Made of red sandstone all the way up, the two stories at the top are of white marble. This portion of the minaret was completed by his successor, Firoz Shah Tughlaq, in 1386 AD. The Qutb Minar comprises of several superposed flanged and cylindrical shafts separated by balconies. The minaret is made of fluted red sandstone covered with intricate carvings and verses from the Quran. Surrounding the building are many fine examples of Indian artwork. The nearby iron pillar, built during the Gupta era around 500 AD, is the world's foremost metallurgical curiosities, standing in the famous Qutb complex. The historical city of Fatehpur Sikri was constructed by the Mughal Emperor Akbar during 1570 and served as the empire's capital from 1571 until 1585. Though the fort took 15 years to build, it was abandoned after only 14 years because the water supply was unable to sustain the growing population. As one walks inside the barren palaces and halls, the great majesty and excellence of Mughals slowly unfold in front of you. Being childless, Akbar consulted Salim Chishti, the Sufi saint who lived as a recluse in the small town Sikri near Agra. Salim Chishti predicted that Akbar would have another son, and indeed, one was born in 1569 in Sikri. He was named Salim to honor the saint and would later rule the empire as Emperor Jahangir. The name Fateh in Arabic in origin means victory. Built by Akbar for his Rajput wife Jodhabai, the palace flaunts the spirit of Hinduism in every bit of its corner. The large courtyard, square doors in place of archways and jutting balconies over doors, all flaunt the Hindu architecture that blends beautifully with the Mughal style, with domed turrets and excellent interior ornamentation. The number of architectural treasures that ornate the city with colors of red and pink is the finest treasures of Mughal artistry and art. The majestic marble and red stone structures of the city still narrate the formidable past of the ancient city. As one walks inside the barren palaces and the halls, the great majesty and excellence of the Mughals slowly unfolds in front of you. Fatehpur Sikri, which was once abandoned by Akbar, has not lost its charm even a bit after so many years. The hustle bustle may not be echoed from the abandoned lanes of the city anymore, but the exquisite architectural splendor of Fatehpur Sikri has left a permanent impression of legacy of Indo-Islamic architecture. Agra Fort is about 2.5 kilometers northwest of its much more famous sister monument, the Taj Mahal. The fort can be accurately described as a walled palatial city. It is the most important fort in India. The great Mughals, Humayun, Akbar, Jahangir, Shah Jahan and Aurangzeb lived here, and the Mughal Empire was governed from here. It contained the largest state treasury and mint. It was visited by foreign ambassadors, travelers, and highest dignitaries who participated in the making of history in India. Babur stayed in this fort. Humayun was crowned here in 1530. The Afghan Sher Shah held the fort for 5 years after defeating Humayun. The Mughals defeated the Afghans finally at Panipat in 1556. Realizing the importance of its central situation, Akbar decided to make it his capital and arrived in Agra in 1558. The brick fort was in a ruined condition and Akbar had it rebuilt with red sandstone. Architects laid the foundation and it was built with bricks in the inner core with sandstone on external surfaces. Over 1 million workers worked on it for 8 years, completing it in 1573. Akbar's son Jahangir mostly resided at Lahore and in Kashmir, though he visited Agra regularly and lived in the fort. It was during the reign of Akbar's grandson Shah Jahan that the site finally took on its current state. The legend is that Shah Jahan built the beautiful Taj Mahal for his wife Mumtaz Mahal. Unlike his grandfather, Shah Jahan tended to have buildings made from white marble, often inlaid with gold or semi-precious gems. He destroyed some of the earlier buildings inside the fort. Aurangzeb imprisoned Shah Jahan, his own father, in the fort for 8 years until he died in 1666 and was buried in the Taj Mahal. After the death of Shah Jahan, Agra lost its grandeur. Aurangzeb remained busy in the regional conflicts and wars, yet time and again he lived here and held the Darbar. Aurangzeb died in 1707 and the 18th century history of Agra Fort is a saga of sieges and plunder, during which it was held by the Jats and the Marathas, and finally the British captured it from the latter in 1803. The Taj Mahal incorporates and expands on design traditions of Persian architecture and earlier Mughal architecture. In 1631, Shah Jahan was grief-stricken when his third wife Mumtaz Mahal died during the birth of their 14th child. A year after her death, construction began. The court chronicles of Shah Jahan's grief illustrates the love story traditionally held as an inspiration for Taj Mahal. The Taj Mahal complex is bounded on three sides by crenellated red sandstone walls. Outside the walls are several additional mausoleums. These structures, composed of primarily of red sandstone, are typical of smaller Mughal tombs of the era. The garden facing inner sides of the wall are fronted by column arcades, a feature typical of Hindu temples, which was later incorporated into Mughal mosques. Emperor Shah Jahan himself described the Taj in these words: "Should the guilty seek asylum here, like one pardoned, he becomes free from sin. Should a sinner make his way to this mansion, all his past sins are to be washed away. The sight of this mansion creates sorrowing sighs, and the sun and the moon shed tears from their eyes. In this world, this edifice has been made to display thereby the Creator's glory."